data, the causes of this big data, what is NoSQL, then MapReduce, Hadoop, then why we need MapReduce, then issues with Hadoop, and then my references. So now let us understand how big the problem is. Can you tell me what is big data? Yeah, what is a database?
It is used to store data in the form of relational.
In the form of relational tables and all. Okay, that means you are only talking about the structured data. Actually, the biggest constraint with the SQL or a relational database is that the type of data that DBMS is doing dealing with is the structured data. Structural data means any identifiable data that is stored in the database in the form of rows and columns. Fine, but in this talk, I'm not talking about that data. Means that stored in the rows and column, typical rows and columns. So my data is like the images, the sound, the videos. How Facebook is handling that much amount of data, the exabytes of data, 2^50, 2^60. So how Facebook, how YouTube, how Google is dealing with that much amount of data. He'll not be using the normal RDBMS. He's not running SQL queries. So what is the need of this MapReduce, this Hadoop, Hive, Pig, Bigtable and all? So according to the IDC paper, till 2006, we have created just 161 exabytes of data. But in 2010, we have created 988 exabytes of data. So exabytes means 2^60, I guess. So you can imagine how big the problem is.
Power 60.
It's not 80.
Beta. Beta is
2^60. It's exa and then zeta. Zeta is 2^70. This exa is 2^60, and then beta is 2^50.
60.
Yeah. Maybe I am wrong, but
18.
Okay, maybe 18. Sir, I think you are wrong this time. I think you are wrong. Sir, you should check it. Yeah, I am also happy if you are wrong. So, this is according to the IDC paper. The Eric Schmidt, the Google CEO, also said that till 2003, we have created just 5 exabytes. We are creating much amount of data every day. She's checking online. So you can imagine the problem of big data in this real world. This is the worldwide growth of emails. You can relate from 1998 to 2010.
One exabyte is equal to 1000 petabyte. One exabyte is equal to 1000 petabyte.
Okay. What you found out?
Equal to 10^6 gigabytes.
Okay, let me say. Kilobyte, megabyte, gigabyte, terabyte, petabyte, exabyte, zetabyte, and then yottabyte. So yottabyte is the biggest unit till now. So means the yottabyte is 2^80. 80. Yeah. 80. I'm not confident enough. If you all are saying I'm wrong, then I may be wrong.
Because we have actually done that and we are observers.
So, what is actually the causes of this data? Okay. But maybe 10^10. Yeah, 10^10.
But 2^16 and all was happening in 1970s.
That's what I'm saying. It's 2^80.
Or 2^68. What about this 2^10^24 or 2^80?
You can leave it. So, causes of this data. Actually, the needs of enterprises is increasing. Now, the needs is the velocity, the variety, and the volume of this data. So, the companies are not bothering about what type of data it is. The company is saying just store this data, like Google. What the Google is doing? When you are doing search on the Google, then do you think that Google is not taking your information? Google is storing every aspect of your information, around 8 aspects. Like like your location, your age group, what type of information you are searching, everything. Because there are a lot of enterprises who are hungry for information, hungry for information related to a certain amount of certain set of peoples for their corporate exploitation. So the needs of enterprises. The second thing is cost of storage. Storage is decreased significantly. Like you can go to the market and take a 1 terabyte hard disk for just 4,000 rupees, I guess. So 6,000. So the cost is decreased significantly. So improvement in the processor designs also. The problem is not with structured data, because there is a relational database that can handle structured data easily. But we are bothering about unstructured data. Unstructured data is that data that cannot be stored in the rows and columns. So we have to deal with that unstructured data. So over 95% of the digital universe is unstructured data. It's currently, according to the ID paper. So in organization, unstructured data accounts for more than 80% of the information. So we have to deal with this problem. So now, what do we have for managing data? There are two types of techniques, relational database system and NoSQL. NoSQL is not only SQL. We have to take something more. The relational database works well in case of structured data. Data is stored in a definite structures and uses SQL for as a query language. But what is NoSQL? No.
Those two people are more important than
that. Which one? Oh, the code and that one. Okay. Sorry. So NoSQL is not only SQL. Actually, you must have read that SQL or relational database work on a principle, the asset properties, atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. So every transaction has to follow these properties. But if I am talking about the distributed environment, so I have to relax something so that my liberty can be increased and the processing speed can be faster. Like I have to relax the atomicity property or the consistency property or the isolation property. I have to relax something. So that relaxation is not provided by this relational database. So this is the biggest constraint. Second constraint is that there is no flexibility. Means the schema is there, definite structure is there. So NoSQL is just stands for not only SQL. Classes of non-relational storage system usually do not require any fixed table structure. Instead of using asset properties, NoSQL app theorem. That is consistency, availability, and partition tolerance. So CAP theorem is given by Brewer's. Brewer's theorem states that any distributed database cannot achieve these three things simultaneously. The consistency, the availability, and the partition tolerance. What is consistency? Can anybody tell me? Like in normal sense, in the real world. What is consistency?
Exactly.
But in the distributed environment, if I am talking about consistency, the consistency means is that let's say I have two nodes, a distributed environment. You're getting what is distributed environment? Like the set of computers. The data cannot be stored in a single computer. The data is distributed across the computers. Like I have 100 computers in my cluster. So in that environment, consistency means is if I am storing some data X on one machine and a user comes and update that data X, and after some time T, another user comes and want to read that data from another machine, then will we be able to read the updated version of data X or the previous version of data X? So that is what the consistency is all about. But if I'm using relational database, the answer is yes, because relational database is always consistent. But if I'm using NoSQL, the answer is maybe he get the updated record or he get the previous record. Fine. So that's what the consistency is all about. CAP theorem classifies the databases as the Vertica. It is column-oriented database. I'm not talking about column-oriented database. Just forget about it. Vertica, the traditional database, the green pump. No, CAP theorem classifies the databases on the basis of the concerning factors, like the database which concerned about the consistency and atomicity, the database that concerned about atomicity and partition tolerance, the database that concerned about the atomicity and partition tolerance.
Yeah, column oriented, we have all the asset properties.
That column oriented, pardon?
Column oriented database.
Huh.
acid properties.
All have acid properties. No, Vertica doesn't have acid properties. Vertica is based on cap theorem, not acid properties.
So what is
actually Vertica is a distributed database. Sir, Hadoop is also a column-oriented database.
Maybe using column-oriented, but not exactly. My Vertica distributed. Is it distributed? But maybe using column-oriented. But column-oriented doesn't.
Actually, sir, this column-oriented database, key-value-oriented database, or documented database. Sir, these three databases are classified on the basis of how these databases are storing data. These are storing on the basis of columns. These are storing on the basis of rows. Just like your RDBMS. RDBMS is storing on the basis of rows. But column oriented database just storing on the basis of columns. So that for a particular queries that.
How does that CAP theorem apply there?
CAP theorem places Vertica here. CAP theorem doesn't tell about Vertica. Means it a column oriented or a row oriented. Or no, it doesn't say. CAP theorem just classifies this Vertica here. That is Vertica mainly focuses on consistency and availability.
Which company?
Vertica is, I don't know the name of the company. Actually, I know just 4 or 5 databases like Bigtable, Peanuts, Hadoop. These are new, pretty new ones. And then Dynamo. IQ also. This Cassandra by Facebook. Yeah, these databases focuses on consistency and partition tolerance. Fine. Like Bigtable is used by Google presently. Which one?
Hypertable is used by
Google. Hypertable? Don't know.
MongoDB.
No. Pass.
Berkeley is the oldest thing that we are talking about.
Berkeley DB is a database. It is used by Berkeley. The old one. Actually, the focus of this presentation is on Hadoop. The main motto of this presentation is just to explore the what is going on in the field of database. Like the research prospects. Like what are the flaws in Hadoop? The areas where you can explore. So just to make you aware about these. I don't know, means you must be knowing about it, but so this one is Redis. I'm just telling you the issues about Redis. The main issue with Redis is the scalability is poor. What is scalability?
Scalability of the system to perform well under increased loads. I mean, it should perform the same when the loads are increased.
When the load is increased, that means I may be able to add more machines into my system to sustain extra loads. That is scalability. Means in layman terms, I'm not talking about exact definition, but in layman terms. So this lacking this scalability factor, and how Redis works is it loads everything in the RAM, the primary memory, and then performs some operations. So the physical memory is the bottleneck. Means the processing speed, the processing memory is limited. So this one is the lacking factor with Redis. Similarly, there is a Cassandra. The issue with Cassandra is that only horizontal scaling is possible. Actually, there are two types of scalability. There are two types of scaling, horizontal scaling and vertical scaling. Like if you have 100 machines in a cluster and you want to add 5 more machines to increase your computational power, then it becomes horizontal scaling. And if you increase the computational power of the existing machine, like your 2 GB RAM, you make it 4 GB. So that is called vertical scaling. So only horizontal scaling is possible. Vertical scaling is not possible in case of Cassandra. Facebook is using Cassandra.
Hardware scaling or software scaling?
Hardware scaling. Now, what are the challenges in the distributed environment? The first challenge is all the distributed environment is using very cheap nodes. Like if I am the CEO of some company and I'm using 1000 nodes for my cluster, then I can't afford 1000 to be very much expensive. Like I'm using some cheap nodes, like all the commodity nodes will be cheap. So the mean time of failure of one node is 3 years, but mean time of failure of 1000 means every day you have to face failures. So your system must be fault tolerant, but in RDBMS the fault tolerance is very less. Means up to a certain extent, the system is fault tolerant because it is not designed for a distributed environment. So we have to make a system that is fault. The second thing is, we have to take care of bandwidth, network bandwidth. Like, tell me one question. Data is bigger or your is bigger? So, writing some code, let's say 500 lines of code to deal with 500 GBs of database for fetching some queries. So, will it be worth to fetch the data from the database and making in front of code, or fetching code from the code database in the database machine? Which will be better? RDBMS is doing first thing. The machine means the code in the separate machine and the database in the separate machine, and it is just fetching some database from the it is fetching some data from the database. But what if we make some technique that instead of pulling the data from the database, we are pushing our code to the database. So we have to take care about the network bandwidth. This functionality is there in Hadoop. The next thing is, programming distributed environment is hard. Like, we have to take care about pipelining, we have to take care about the parallelization, and we have to take care about the fault tolerance. Everything we have to take care. So programming in such an environment is very difficult. So we have to make a system which is user friendly, that user don't have to be bothered about the parallelization details and pipelining and all. How MapReduce works? Actually, the Hadoop that I am talking about for so long, Hadoop is a Java based software that is working on a MapReduce programming methodology. MapReduce is a programming methodology in which a user write every function in form of MapReduce. Fine. Means for every problem have to be mapped with these two functions. I'll show you with some examples how. So the run system take care of partitioning, scheduling, parallelization, and fault tolerance. So Hadoop is the Apache's Hadoop is the open source Java implementation of MapReduce. For every DBMS, for every database, we need some computational part and some database part. Like how actually the data is being stored in the database. Like if I am talking about RDBMS, the computational part is SQL. Like you are writing every query in SQL. So in this case, I am writing every query in MapReduce, and my storage is HDFS. HDFS is Hadoop Distributed File System. Fine. How HDFS works is, let's say I have a file of 300 MB. How it will get stored in my database? So what HDFS does is, HDFS splits this file into some data block that is user and makes copies of a single. Actually, this factor is, means every block is triplicated. This factor is called replication factor, and replication factor is also user defined, but by default the replication factor is 3. All the data blocks are triplicated, and after that, let's say my cluster, all these, fine, by applying some algorithms, by following some algorithms, there's a name node called data nodes, and this node, actually monitor node or name node, tracks all the blocks, means where these blocks are stored, like the green one, the blue one, and the brown one. What is the need of the tracking? If a node get down in case of failure, fault tolerance. I'm talking about fault tolerance, how this is achieved in case of Hadoop. So if node goes down, then the complete But there is a problem with this mechanism. Actually, can you figure out? Means it's very lemon. If this node, then the mapping is saved here, and we again recover that triplication by redistributing that. So if this node goes down, then what will happen? Actually, this is the current problem with Hadoop. And researches are going on that how can we again put up some secondary machines in the then everything is gone. So that's why it's open yet. Means we are just considering that this name node is very efficient, high quality RAM, high quality hard disk, and everything is high quality. We are just considering that. So let's take an example to understand what how Hadoop works. So I just said two types of functions. The how many name nodes? I have not analyzed Facebook quantitatively. Sorry, I don't know.
they
don't have one. Actually,
means.
Don't know. So I am talking about an example. You are getting, na? I just want some feedback. So let's take an example. When you program and when you make some program in C programming or Java, then first program, what is your first program? It's we are expected hello world program. So in the same way in the Hadoop, we make some the word frequency program. Word frequency means you have given some file, that 300 MB file, and you have to calculate the frequency of each word. That is like an hello world program in case of Hadoop. Fine. So how this word count problem will be solved by map reduce functions? So actually, what are map and reduce? Let me explain on the physical basis. Actually, let's say I have a cluster of 100 machines and I have some monitor node. That monitor node will deploy some node as a mapper, as a reducer. Fine. That mapper node will do the function of mappings, and then reducer node will do the function of reducing. So what are mappings and reducing, how these are working, this I am explaining. Let's say need some key and some value. Let's say this is some sentence, some arbitrary sentence, and I have to calculate the frequency of each word in this sentence. So I am giving an offset. Zero means the offset of this line in the file. This is the zeroth line of that file, in that file. The offset plus the value. Value means the content itself. So I'm giving this to the mapper. And a small script is written in mapping. Mapper. Like first it will split and then emit word comma one. Means it just attach one to every word in the file. Fine. So that's what mappers is doing. So this is data node, and in every data node, this mapping function is going on. Similarly, in all the data nodes, this mappers. Can I emit? Then it will show error. Simple. Then it will show error.
Why?
Where? Means actually for printf we need a console.
Okay, actually in F printf.
F printf. You are putting it in a file. Then it will show. Yeah, then it will show. But if you simply write printf, then it needs a console to print.
Then we can pipe it.
We can pipe it then. So similarly on all the data nodes, this mapping function is going on. When this mapping function will complete, that means I have attached an integer 1 to every word of the file, then I need to calculate the number of ones for a particular word. That's how the problem is solved. So for on every machine, this type of file will appear, like 4, 1, score, 1, and means 1 is attached with every word. So a shuffle function is there on every node that will shuffle. That means A can appear multiple times in a file, multiple times on a data node. So this will shuffle everyone. So now the reducer come into picture. The monitor node deploy all the mappers as a reducer and send this code to the reducer. So what reducer does is it just merges the list of ones from all the data nodes. So that's how the word frequency program is achieved. Fine. Means it's very simple. Now Facebook is not doing simple thing. Hello world is a simple thing. What are the positives about MapReduce? The fault tolerance is achieved at the runtime scheduling. Runtime scheduling. What I mean is, if you are using RDBMS, then you know that writing some queries, a query plan will be generated after you sending that query. Fine. And that query, according to that query plan, everything will be done. Fine. So we can say that everything is done statically, means everything is done according to that query plan. But there is no such query plan in MapReduce. So everything is done at runtime, so that if a machine goes down, then the function of that machine can be handled by some other machine. So that machine is called straggling node, means the slower nodes. Fine. So query plan tree is generated first in RDBMS. This is the lacking factor in RDBMS, why we are not using in case of distributed system, or in case of big, not distributed system. Load balancing is achieved by the runtime scheduling, that straggling node factor. And it is very simple, only two functions are there, mapping and reducing. Independent of storage, because HDFS is there and everything has to be loaded in the HDFS. Scalability is there, flexibility is there. Flexibility means no need of schema and all.
How do you know what it is?
Actually, the data it is working on doesn't fit in schema. Then how will you fit video in schema?
It's data. Any data, if you don't know what it is, how would you know what it is after getting the results also? There is no schema. Because schema gives you...
Sir, like the program which I explained, the word count problem.
So there must be some other schema generation.
Let's say, I'm giving you one real world example. Like, if you want to calculate the popularity of a website. Only link is there and number of clicks is there.
That is schema.
You can say a log file. It's not schema, it is a log file. It can vary it. Actually, for if you are using a schema, then that becomes fixed. You can't vary it.
You're talking popularity.
Popularity, yeah.
Website is accessed by million and million of people.
Yeah.
So you want to see the traces where it is.
Where it is being called and where we are accessed. That itself is a schema, but
it is not explicitly stated.
You can say that it is a semi-structured database.
Even when they are putting SQL on it.
We can do it in SQL, but if the size of this file become large.
They are still putting SQL on it, some SQL.
On Hadoop? Not exactly SQL, it's HiveQL. HiveQL, yeah. But sir, that HiveQL language, I'm talking about this. So, what are the negatives of Hadoop?
This hurts me, no schema hurts me a lot.
So, actually, these all are the open problems. Open problems means you can have a research on it. So, what are the negatives? Focusing on the scalability but missing performance. Scalability and performance means, like say, recall that example, that every file is triplicated. So, for storing one file, for storing one data block, I need three machines. Just to ensure the availability. Fine. Just to ensure availability, I am putting on three machines. Just for the storing of one data block. So, don't you think that it is a wastage of performance of three machines? So, this is the current problem with scale. Actually, there are solutions, but that solutions are also not enough. So, trade-off between efficiency and fault tolerance. And no high-level language. Like, means it seems that it is very easy to write mapping and reducing function, but it's not so easy because it was very simple program. But if you write some bigger problems, then it will be very cumbersome to write mapping and reducing functions because you have to tokenize everything, you have to write down everything. Means if you are an SQL person, then it will be very difficult to write mapping and reducing function. So you need some SQL like language. Fine. So and this one is the important point. It is not exploiting pipelining. Pipelining means, in case of RDBMS, you make some query tree, query plan. In query plan, the intermediate results, producing, achieving that result, final result, the intermediate results are pipelined into the next stage. Fine. Means we are not storing the pipeline intermediate result. So if a machine goes down, then the query has to be restarted from the scratch, but it is not using pipelining. There are currently it is not, because we are not using pipelining for the sense that as a technique we can use.
So if that is used, then will that negative point will go?
That go.
Sure.
But that depends on the application, sir. But because we have to achieve the fault tolerance also. And if I'm using pipelining, that fault tolerance property will go on. So we have to take care about every factors. You're not sure? So, sir, check it out. I'm sorry. Sir, how you can achieve both?
You don't achieve both. Fault tolerance you are putting by replicating first of all. How are you doing fault tolerance?
Fault tolerance, yeah, replication.
Nothing, you are doing replication. 3 and 4 or 10 or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And now, in between, I put pipeline.
Sir, there are two senses of pipelining. I am not talking about that pipelining. I am talking about...
It is different.
Yeah. Actually, there are two sorts of pipelining. Like first pipelining, I am explaining first aspect of pipelining. Mappers, and after completing the job mappers, I am deploying the same machine as a. Why can't I do some machine as a reducer? Things will go, but that is not Hadoop is not doing this. Hadoop is assigning everything as a mapper, and once all the mapping task is completed. That sense, no. That's what I was talking with Fatak sir. That why can't we do this in my seminar presentation? No extra computation, same computation. Yeah. But the need of reducer is that actually one reducer can take data. The reason why this is doing this. These are the differences in Hadoop and distributed DBMS, which I think almost I have covered everything regarding cost. Okay, I'm going a bit faster. Yeah, this actually map reduce in front of Hadoop is just like programming language. C programming and assembly language. You can't write assembly language for load store instructions. So we don't write mapping and reducing function for every program. So we need some language on Hadoop layer on the top of layer. So that language is PIG. PIG is SQL sort of language, but not exactly SQL. You can see the sample query. Actually, it is procedural language. Like it is explicitly saying that this line, tokenize this line, grouping this line, and for each group send count the number of words. So the better option is Hive. Hive is almost like SQL, and the language is SQL. Let's say select customer last name, order item. It's almost like SQL. So these are the both the languages convert their queries in MapReduce functions internally, and these are the differences in Hive and PIG. One is procedural, one is similar to SQL using Thrift Server, one is not. Hive has partitions which speed. So thank you, these are my references. Next, I will tackle that. So thank you.